欢迎收看今天的汉天新闻，我是赵子彤。首先来看美国国内消息。据美国 CNN 报道，美国众议院民主党、众议院监督党、众议院监督与改革委员会主席卡明斯于当地时间17日凌晨离世，终年68岁。卡明斯办公室当日发表声明说，卡明斯在17日凌晨2时在约翰霍普金斯医院去世，死因是长期健康问题导致的并发症。卡明斯离世的消息传出后，白宫和国会分别降半旗向其哀致，美国政界人士纷纷发表声明表示哀悼。
Capitol Hill in mourning.
We have lost a great American.
Democrat Elijah Cummings, representative of the 7th Congressional District of Maryland since 1996, chairman of the House Oversight Committee, civil rights advocate, and fierce champion of his native Baltimore, died early Thursday morning, his office said, at the age of 68, the result of longstanding health challenges.
It's very sad for all of us. We've all lost a friend. I'm devastated by the loss.
Fellow Maryland Democrat Jamie Raskin, also a member of the Oversight Committee, said that Cummings' legacy will loom large, especially as Democrats continue their impeachment inquiry.
What Elijah gave us was this moral resonance and texture to everything that we did.
The tributes also coming from Republicans, like Senator Lindsey Graham of South Carolina.
He was a good man. If you disagreed with him, that was okay, because he would help you where he could.I think he represented sort of the best of what a congressman is like.
And two of President Trump's staunchest defenders in the House. Cummings had a close friendship with Congressman Mark Meadows of North Carolina, who said Thursday he is heartbroken. And Jim Jordan of Ohio, the top Republican on the Oversight Committee, mourned Cummings as a man of great consequence and significance. Flags at the White House and the Capitol were lowered to half staff Thursday morning. In Washington, I'm Karen Kafa.
佛罗里达警方日前公布了一则监控录像视频，显示一名15岁少年驾车穿越了美国和加拿大边境。警方称，这名少年不久前在佛罗里达杀害了他的祖母，驾驶的是祖母的汽车，目前正在面临通缉。他被认为对社会存在严重威胁，可能携带多把枪支和刀具。
This never-before-seen dashcam video shows a 15-year-old Logan Mott driving up to a window at the border of New York and Canada on November 24th,
2017.
How you doing, man?
I took a long turn.
I left at the hotel.
Mott pulls up and tells the officer he's from Florida and is visiting family for Thanksgiving.
Family's down in the city.
We're
down at the hotel.
Oh, Bear Drive used to be right there. It's closed now. There was never a hotel on Bear Drive.
The Border Patrol officer realizes Mott has a warrant.
1022, lane 15, one occupant. Put both your hands. Don't move your hands. I swear to God, I will shoot you. Do you understand me? Now, it's a simple question. Do you have an arrest warrant?You don't think you have an arrest warrant?
Okay.
Keep your hands right there. If you move your hands, it's going to be an issue. Do you understand?
Any weapons in the vehicle tonight?
Mott is taken out of the car and put in handcuffs. Police say this is the same day Mott's grandmother, Christina French, was found buried in the backyard of his father's Neptune Beach home. During Mott's sentencing hearing on Wednesday, Mott's father, Eric Mott, took the stand.He told the state he's part of the blame for Mott's actions based on how he was raised.
I think any rational parent would take a significant amount of blame for the outcome of their child.
再来看国际方面的消息。美国副总统彭斯和国务卿蓬佩奥于当地时间10月17日在土耳其首都安卡拉宣布，经过与土耳其总统埃尔多安开会磋商调停，土耳其同意与叙利亚库尔德人之间达成停火协议。根据协议，土耳其军队将在120个小时之内停火，让库尔德人的武装部队有足够的时间撤退。在库尔德人完全撤军后，土耳其部队也将收兵。川普总统对此表示赞赏。
Cameras were not allowed inside during the majority of the U.S.-Turkey ceasefire negotiations, but right after the hours-long meeting between Turkey and the U.S., Vice President Pence spoke to reporters claiming victory.
Turkey and the United States of America have agreed to a ceasefire in Syria. It will be a pause in military operations for 120 hours, while the United States facilitates the withdrawal of YPG from the affected areas in the safe zone. And once that is completed, Turkey has agreed to a permanent ceasefire.
President Trump touting the deal after landing in Texas for a fundraiser and campaign rally.
This is an amazing outcome.
Vice President Pence says U.S. sanctions placed on Turkey last week will be lifted once the ceasefire becomes permanent. That could happen after Kurdish-led forces leave the safe zone.
I know it's already underway as we speak.
Turkish officials telling CNN they got exactly what they wanted out of the meeting. But later, Turkey's foreign minister saying in a press conference, quote, "This is not a ceasefire." Before the deal was announced, the House approved a resolution opposing President Trump's decision to remove U.S. troops from Syria. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi saying it could lead to a possible resurgence of ISIS.
Calls for the president to show a clear plan for how Americans will be protected from ISIS.
In Washington, I'm Nadia Romero reporting.
周三，美国总统川普因决定从叙利亚东北部撤军而遭到两党议员的强烈指责，其中包括他的关键盟友参议员林赛·格拉汉姆。美国国会众议院星期四以压倒性多数投票赞成一项谴责川普决定的决议。在过去的一周之中，格拉汉姆和川普一直陷入在持续的口水战中，两位共和党人复杂的关系时也得到了政治专家的细致分析。
Lindsey Graham is frantic.
He's making the biggest mistake of his presidency.
Donald Trump is annoyed.
I think Lindsey should focus right now on judiciary.
Lindsey Graham is warning about terror attacks.
He will have American blood on his hands if he abandons Kurds because ISIS will come back.
Donald Trump doesn't want to hear it.
The Democrats, the do-nothing Democrats, as I call them.
Listening to that, it's hard to believe Graham is one of Trump's most loyal allies. It's like a time warp back to their campaign rivalry.
I don't think he has the temperament or judgment to be commander-in-chief.
Then, 2016 Graham warned voters about exactly what 2019 Graham is apoplectic about now, that Trump's promise to withdraw troops from the Middle East will make America less safe.
For God's sakes, pick somebody who is worthy of the sacrifice of those who are fighting this war and who actually knows how to win, and I don't believe that's Mr. Trump.
For Graham and Trump, it's complicated, very complicated. On abandoning the Kurds, U.S. allies against ISIS, Graham says he's holding Trump to the Obama standard.
By assuming the Kurds are better off today than they were yesterday, that is just unbelievable. I can imagine if Obama said that, what Republicans would be saying now. So I'm going to say it with Trump. That is just unfair, dangerous.
Good afternoon.
But what if Obama called a foreign leader and asked for dirt on his political rival, like Trump did with Ukraine's president on Biden? It's hard to imagine Graham would say, no big deal, like he is now.
This phone call is a nothing burger.
In fact, Graham is still staunchly defending Trump.
Thank you very much. Been a good hearing.
Even using his powerful role as Senate Judiciary Chairman to backstop the president against the House Democrats' impeachment inquiry.
I can do two things at once.
But that's not how the president seems to see it.
He ought to find out about what happened with Comey.
Senator, what is the president's mood today?
Trump seems almost disoriented that Graham is not singularly focused on settling scores against Democrats.
What happened with President Obama? What happened with Brennan? That's what Lindsey ought to focus on. That's what the people of South Carolina want him to focus on.
It's not about me and him. It's about the country.
Yet it is about the two of them. Being close to Trump helps Graham, who is up for re-election in South Carolina, where the president has so much support, a top Graham aide calls it Trumpistan. Trump treasures Graham as a golf buddy and a navigator in the ways of Washington. But we now know Graham's influence, his attempts to curb the president's isolationist worldview, has limits.
Lindsey Graham would like to stay in the Middle East for the next 1,000 years with thousands of soldiers and fighting other people's wars. I want to get out of the Middle East.
Facebook 首席执行官扎克伯格日前在乔治敦大学的一次演讲中捍卫了言论自由。他表示，互联网使人们可以共享以前无法共享的内容，但是我们看到各行各业的人都试图将更多言论定义为威胁言论，因为这可能导致他们认为不可接受的政治结果。他承认，言论限制一直是美国政治氛围的一部分，但他呼吁采取一种尽可能减少限制的方案，而决定权不落在私人公司的手里。
Hey everyone, it's really great to be here at Georgetown with all of you today. Before we get started, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge that today we lost an icon, Elijah Cummings. He was a powerful voice for equality and for social progress and for bringing people together. Back when I was in college, our country had just gone to war in Iraq. And the mood on our campus was disbelief. A lot of people felt like we were acting without hearing a lot of important perspectives. And the toll on soldiers and their families and our national psyche was severe, yet most of us felt like we were powerless to do anything about it. And I remember feeling that if more people had a voice to share their experiences, then maybe it could have gone differently. And those early years shaped my belief that giving more people a voice gives power to the powerless and pushes society to get...
休息一下，马上回来。